that at one time people had wanted me to contest the presidency. So I was a thorn in the flesh of government.
Okay.
It is true.
Yes.
So there was, they used that tactic to get rid of me in parliament.
Some steps back.
Yeah. Yeah. That was at the time when I had just been pronounced one of the best parliamentarians. I had just moved a motion to oblige the government of Uganda to talk to Lord Resistance Army outside Uganda in Juba. All motions of great importance, particularly those on the opposition, were channeled through the man.
John Ken Lukyamuzi.
What are those motions you are proud of as an individual?
I am proud of the motion which relates to the Land Act 2004.
What was your role in that?
I was the key mover of the amendment from the 1998 Land Act, where it was said that the Bibanja holders would pay 1,000 shillings to the landlords. The law created a stalemate between the two parties. Neither did the landlord ask for 1,000 shillings, nor did the Kibanja holder submit. That law was senseless because one was supposed to pay 1,000 shillings to the landowner, regardless of the size of that Kibanja, even if it was 2 miles, as compared to or related to a one acre Kibanja. So that amendment I caused intended to say that from now onwards, or from then, the busuru fee to be paid by the Kibanja holder should be determined by the district land boards in conjunction with the landlords and the Bibanja holders.
And that became part of the law?
Yeah, the president refused to assent to that bill, but it came back under 91, Article 91. When the president refuses to sign a bill and it comes back after 60 days and it is passed again, it becomes law. It became law, but the government became very sensitive about that law and refused to fund the district land boards and the tribunals that would have settled petty land disputes. That is why as we speak now, the calamity which has led to over 10,000 land cases as a backlog in the register of the judiciary is as a result of the failure of government to sanction the Lukyamuzi amendment. Otherwise, if the Lukyamuzi amendment had passed and funded, it was passed, but if it had been funded, we would not be in this quagmire. What is happening today is disastrous because of the Bibanja people failing to pay the busuru, because there is now a redundancy over the fees to be paid. The ordinary Kibanja holder predominantly does not have the statute of occupancy. So the Chinese, in collaboration with some landlords, find it easier to get rid of people or to mini-pay the Bibanja holders because they have no pleadings related to security of occupancy.
Your name and DDT have always been in one sentence in almost every article. Give us a brief story about that in just a minute.
I resisted the application of DDT to get rid of mosquitoes. I said between the mosquito and the DDT, it is like you trying to gun down an eagle using AK-47. The chemical toxin is too strong for use as a repellent for malaria. And I succeeded. I went all over Uganda to demonstrate the agony related to the application of DDT in people's houses. That is why predominantly people are free from the toxin.
Okay. Do you see the parliaments that have come after your group having MPs like you and your colleagues? When you listen to the Norbert Maos of this world, yourself,
Ekule Park,
all those people.
Kero.
Exactly. Do you see the parliaments? Yes. Do you see the parliaments that have come after you giving us that breed of members of parliament?
I don't see even a near reflection of what I used.
What do you think went wrong?
First of all, the parliament is too big. to be administered. When you want to be a good deliberator, you should be free enough, even in the city, physical sitting. Nobody can subscribe to a debate in 2 minutes meaningfully. I have been part of the gallery in the House of Commons, and the members of parliament reasonably speak for about 5 minutes. In terms of time use and measure, 5 minutes is big enough for you to articulate your point. But what can you say in 1 minute or 2 minutes? As if that was not enough. Predominantly in our parliament now, when you see, if you have ever been to the House of Commons, what is on now in Uganda's parliament is chaotic. You know, if you want to bring a matter of public concern, you have to talk to the speaker ahead of time. That spectrum internationally was left to enable a member of parliament to attack weak ministers without notice. But in the Uganda's parliament, you have to see the speaker first so that she or he communicates to the minister before you bring a question. And it does not help the process where you are checking wrongdoers.
So the problem is structural within the parliamentary setting in Uganda?
Yeah.
Why we don't have debate?
I hope the Right Honorable Lanya will reflect a picture of substance in terms of discussion. Otherwise, if we go back to where we have been, it is absurd.
It has nothing to do with the quality of the MPs that we send from the village.
It has nothing to do with the quality. And even the induction. Induction in the 11th parliament was almost zero. We were exposed to very distinguished speakers. The Speaker of Zambia, the Speaker of the Kenyan parliament, the Speaker of the British parliament, the Speaker of the Malawi Parliament. We have been accessing various speakers to give us a menu of substance in terms of measure to articulate the issues equitably.
Honorable, you were a darling of people in Rubaga, your constituency.
Yeah.
What went wrong? That even when you got issues with the IGG, they accepted your daughter.
Yeah.
You have been trounced 2016?
Yeah, my dilemma came.
Then, 2021.
My dilemma came, was brought by one Katolbuama. At the time when I had just applied to go back to Makerere for a law degree, is when he started a rumor of fabric, you know, very, very defaming ideas published on CBS. And I did not have time to respond. So people took for granted what he said as a reality. As a result of that, I got even forced to take that first to court. We are in court for that.
With who?
With those who published that story of Katolbuama. It is what enabled him to go through, because he published the story through a popular radio program, which is heard by so many people in Rubaga.
What was he framing you with, that you had stolen?
No, he said we were dealing, my family was dealing with the first family. It was absurd. If there is anybody who has been so sincere about the Museveni government and so critical, it is John Ken Lukyamuzi. I even brought a vote of no confidence in him, and I had wanted to impeach him from the presidency. You remember in the
2013? Yes, but it failed.
Yeah, but people like Katolbuama have their problems. All we would like to ask Katolbuama before God summons him, he must find time to apologize to the Lukyamuzi family in Kyabakuza, because that was a very destructive approach to our reputation, which we have kept for so many years now.
Then what happened in 2021? You were not even number two.
Of course, there was the Kibuyaga, which came and was mounted on us because we were close to Dr. Besigye. I was one of the most close people to Besigye. And I was punished for that. But I don't think many people are surprised why elections went the way they went. That election was determined by social media. There was no campaign, open campaign for the candidates. There was a wave that invaded, the monsoons invaded the Ugandan electorate. We can leave it at that.
Let us talk about the Conservative Party that you head. How far does this party go in Uganda?
Oh, we have a councillor in Soroti.
The biggest you have had is an MP, only one, for the last 35 years.
As in Guru, we have had a councillor in Jinja, councillors. We have had various councillors.
Can you imagine? Do you then compete with other parties that have members of parliament in charge of districts?
The Conservative Party has been represented in Uganda's parliament for 10 years.
We only by one MP? You yourself?
And my daughter, Susan.
Okay.
There's nothing funny about that. She was voted for because she was competent. And such occurrences are commonplace internationally. You have Junior Bush, Junior George Bush Jr.
Even Raila Odinga,
Odingo Odinga, and Raila Odinga Dinga. Yes. Uhuru Kenyatta and Jomo Kenyatta.
So the party has had two MPs?
Honorable Nsubuga Nsambu,
yes.
Honorable Mayanja Nkangi, they are all members of parliament on a CP ticket.
Do we have hope to see MPs from CP 2026 and other years of elections?
Many, even after we have gone, there are many people who are going to emulate the legacy we have left to convince people about the stand of the
country. What are you doing to recruit? What are you doing to popularize this?
One of the charges we are putting over this government is to suffocate the political parties in Uganda. Much as we are protected under Article 71 and 72 respectively, the government under the Public Order Act is treating us as NGOs, as a Boy Scout Association, as a Nakivubo Grocery Association.
Honorable, isn't that an excuse? Because you're not the only political party on the opposition. Your other colleagues within the field have MPs, they're in charge of districts and all that. As a political party, what are you not doing right?
Parties don't necessarily have to be of the same size in terms of performance, as long as they have bases that can stand the test of time in terms of manifestation or constitutions. I don't think there is a political party that has a very sound constitutional background in terms of its objectives as the Conservative Party. One of our dilemmas has basically been that we have not been rich enough to reach various areas to sell our propaganda of the party. But once we get sorted out, we will. As we speak now, the government of Uganda, because of being on the opposition, owes us money which was supposed to be paid by parliament as a result of our representation. That money has not been paid to us, and we are in court with the government.
Does CP have headquarters?
Yes, we are at Kiso's complex. That's where our office is.
There is a secretariat there?
Yeah.
Wow. Traditional parties in Uganda are disintegrating.
Yeah, but do you know why they are disintegrating?
What is the problem?
They are disintegrating because the government is using the parameter of the Public Order Act to buy them off in darkness. And in the end, their support goes on perishing. Once the followers know that our party leaders are being bought, what else do you expect? I'm arguing that because of the poor platform for the political parties to reach the masses, many of those old parties you are talking about are dying. And one of the reasons why they should not die is that if we go strong over the front we have initiated, we would like to openly reject the presence of the Public Order Act because it suffocates the political party activities and it is unconstitutional.
Let us look at this, Honorable. We see parties that come up and they become strong.
I have told you, haven't you been listening to me?
Yes, I have, but give me reason why, because of the Public Order Management Act and actions by government, we see traditional parties going down and new ones coming up. The FDC emerged around 2005, 2006, and it became a vibrant party. up to now, they have had at least a presidential candidate all the time and some good number of MPs.
On two
we see the NUP is now vibrant with the biggest number of MPs on the opposition
side.
They are
depreciating on two grounds. Mm. One is they lack public display in terms of public advocacy. Two, many of them are bought off by the government agents. Because of the poor scene of exposition.
How come the new parties are not
That's
affected?
Why I have already replied. Because these are new. The old parties have not had time to articulate their objectives before the public. The population is growing from time to time. People were used to our politics in the 1980s. In the 1990s, many young people who have been born in the course of this regime need to be updated in terms of philosophy of what we stand for as political parties. Once the atmosphere is open for us to visit various sectors in Uganda, the situation will change because many people would like to know what the Conservative Party stands for that makes it different from other political parties. And that exposition is not common knowledge among the people.
Does that justify the running around of politicians from one party to the other every election?
Those are individual weaknesses, and I condemn them very, very strongly.
Do you know we have politicians that have been in three parties every election? They have a different party.
Yeah, I know. And it is absurd. I hope you are not mistaking some of them joining the fronts or inter-party agencies. You are talking about joining real political parties.
Yes, I know that.
Especially this time round, 2021, we saw a big exodus from the Democratic Party crossing to the National Unity Platform.
Yes, and right now we have a different picture. you know what I mean?
No.
What I'm saying, they are not there also. Are they still there? All of them still in that party? It was because of the atmosphere. The atmosphere is also bad enough to create that situation.
What does that mean? What kind of picture does that give about our politicians when it comes to the way when it comes to respect for multipartism?
The political parties on the opposition should stick to their respective parties, even in situations of poverty. You are not going to move from one party to the other because of money. You are killing the spirit of political parties, because political parties are supposed to be the vanguard of contest in Uganda's politics in accordance with Articles 71, 72. We are fighting back to make sure that the parties dominate the scene of competition in politics, which is not so right now, because those in power want to behave like a Stalin, like a Hitler. And we are fighting tooth and nail to make sure that we have a lively atmosphere to enable us to articulate the objectives of our respective political parties.
You can't preach democracy because you are not democratic yourselves. You can't stick to your parties. How do you fail to ensure democracy and stability in a party?
Is the NRM democratic? Tell me. I'm also challenging you comparatively.
First answer me, I'll answer you, Honorable.
What is your question?
Yes. If we have seen party presidents failing to ensure democracy and stability within their parties, can they really have the moral authority to promise it to us, the whole of the country?
Yes. The first key of democracy or democratic principle is the government of Uganda now. For example, the agony it has subjected to the constitution of Uganda, which is supposed to be guiding us, is good enough to explain to you that we have started this story very miserably, very badly. As we speak now, the constitution of Uganda has been butchered to the extent where the parameter of two-term limit that would have directed this country to a change of government has been muddled. What about the age limit benchmark, which is supposed also to guarantee the transfer of power from one leader to the other? It has been muddled up. What about the elections, general elections? Can anybody be proud of elections going on now when we have been in the Supreme Court in the past elections on three consecutive occasions with the judges saying, yes, the vote rigging has been massive, but it did not subscribe to the substantial figures articulated in the Presidential Elections Act. That kind of nonsense is absurd.
You are hiding away from the facts about the weaknesses from within your group as the opposition.
I am saying that those weaknesses you are viewing are caused by the bad administrative atmosphere enshrined in Uganda.
Weaknesses like failure to stick to party ideologies and keep there. How come we have politicians like you that have been CP since we are in primary school up to now? Haven't you seen new parties yourself?
Yes, I have seen them,
yes.
But have remained
intact.
What is
so different between you and other politicians?
I am persuading others to behave like John Ken Lukyamuzi because it does not pay.
How come the government weaknesses have not affected you as a person to leave your party?
Yet because I am myself. I love my party. You cannot buy me as if you are buying tomatoes.
Thank you so much. To you watching, we are having the Honorable John Ken Lukyamuzi, the man, and we are discussing a number of issues here to do with the politics of Uganda, Africa, and the world. Thank you so much for watching. Enjoy this break.
My home, I smile when I think of you, Uganda. My home. My home, I dance when I...
This evening is the break we are still discussing politics, Uganda, Africa, and the world in general. And my guest this evening is none other than the man himself, John Ken Lukyamuzi, from of course Rubaga. And we had to come to Rubaga, where his empire bases. Honorable, welcome back from the break.
Thank you very much.
You are part of a group that came up with an idea whose name has become the Front, HC Inde. And actually the name is HC Inde Chabesije. What are you guys trying to come up with? How legal is it? What do you want to do?
It is not HC Inde Chabesije, that is wrong.
That's the name in town?
No, it is the People's Front for Transition.
Mm-hmm.
It is exclusive. It is not equivalent to inter-party spirit of cooperation.
Why am I asking you what is it about?
Yeah.
We had an election. It ended, the winners were announced, and we moved on. What else are you coming up with?
There are many ways of skinning a cat.
Which cat do you want to skin?
There are many ways of skinning a cat. You can use vapor to kill the cat. You can use a needle to kill the cat. You can blow the cat off the ground. We came with that name because we wanted to concentrate our problem to specifics. Unlike the TDA, unlike the Inter-Party Spirit of Cooperation, this is a front that is concentrating on a long-standing problem of Uganda, which is that after a whole 59 years of independence, this country has not had any chance of seeing the change or transfer of power from one president to the other. As if that was not enough, sir, as if that was not enough, we have most of the problems Uganda has had, including the coming of Amin, Obote II, Mwanga, Tito Lutwa, Binaisa, has all tied down to the lack of access to a system which enables Ugandans to move from one top leader to the other. That is why we named that Kisinde, the People's Front for Transition. And we have basic reasons. I can summarize them.
Briefly.
One of them is that since we got our independence, we have had a constitutional problem. The 1995 Constitution was framed up in almost 8 years. We took time to come out with that constitution. And we even got donations from outside Uganda to make sure that we build a framework for government under a basic law. The first dismantling exercise of that constitution on issues related to benchmarks for transition was masterminded by the government in power today, when in the 2005 parliament, they arranged bribery to get rid of the presidential term limits. Number two, in 2017, The other benchmark was also dismantled, the benchmark on age limit. When you clock 75 years, whether you are good, so good that you would rather stay in power, you have to go. The debate that ensued in parliament, I cannot explain. The turmoil mounted on parliament during that debate was terrible. Do you remember how a garrison from president's office moved, soldiers moved to beat up members of parliament? An exercise which even never occurred in 1966 when Obote dismantled the independence constitution of 1962. The constitution of 1995 put in place another benchmark, the benchmark of general elections, that Ugandans do not stop at being the owners of power, but they can, through a general election, change leadership. I don't think there are many Ugandans who can be proud of elections we have had since NRM came to power, especially those recent elections. There have been turmoil. So meaning that in accordance with what we saw on the 14th of January this year, hope to change government through elections is almost dim. No, so what are the remedies? What are the constitutional remedies for Ugandans under circumstances of that magnitude? The remedy is in Article 3 of the Constitution, which says, should anybody dismantle the cause of action articulated by the Constitution of Uganda on how we shall move or change government, any person would be free to intervene and redeem the situation through an action, provided that action is not violent. That's how we are coming in. We are not coming in illegally. We are coming in constitutionally and legally.
This is an official announcement,
yeah,
that you have failed on elections. You have failed at the floor of parliament. You want to take that kind of...
I don't know whether you have followed me well.
I have followed.
We have not failed. The benchmarks which were constitutionally created to enable the people of Uganda caused the transfer of leadership from one president to the other has deliberately been dismantled by the ruling regime. How have we failed?
Don't we have elections every year?
What elections? Sham elections. The people are not free. We are spectators. We are slaves in our own regime. Look at the way the government of Uganda is using our taxpayers' money. We are not part of the structure of expenditure for this money. That is why Uganda, as we speak now, is one of the countries that is most indebted globally. Don't be surprised one day when the Chinese come at Entebbe to get the airport mortgaged so that they get their payment.
Honorable, let us go slow.
Yes.
How are we not involved with the parliament of 529 members of parliament that we vote for ourselves? To whom do we throw their mistakes?
The rules of procedure for Uganda's parliament are dismantled. How can you say that now, because we lack a space, people will be sitting in shifts? If that shift passes a law which I don't want, and I am a member of parliament, I'm misrepresented.
Let me show you loopholes within the front. You want to confront a system. How ready are you, and why do you think they will look at you, confront them?
No, I'm returning the ball.
What means are you going to use
First of all, I'm returning the ball to the owners of the football. The owners of football are the people. Under Article 1, power belongs to the people. When you vote a government in power, it is supposed to be an employee of the state, of the people of Uganda. Even after 5 years, the people of Uganda renew their powers over that state. What is happening is the contrary. These people
What different are those people going to do?
When I say that we are now going to speak as a group on behalf of the people of Uganda under the cover of the front, the People's Front for Transition, I am inviting everybody, the priests, our locally, the soldiers, the doctors, the teachers, the farmers, the trade unions, the taxi drivers. I am inviting everybody on board to tell them that your house is burning.
You have had a number of fronts. You've had the People's Government, you've had the People's Government, the Tubalemese, there was the Busepichi kind of arrangement, and a number of them. All of these have failed.
Can this government be proud that it has won past elections you have been referring to?
They are proud, they say it.
In 2016, Dr. Besigye was charged with treason.
Yes.
Because he got sworn in as a president. They detained him, suffocated him, persecuted him, miserably treated him. Eventually was given bail. 5 years after that bail, the court is saying you have no case to answer. Which means if the case, the treason case is withdrawn, he emerges as the president who must have won the 2016 general elections.
What are the chances that you will see reality of your targets?
The chances?
Yes.
Everyone is bogged down with this regime. Look at what is happening in the sector of education. As we speak now, it is only Uganda whose schools are still closed. The rest of the world has reopened the schools. Look at the international debt with which we have to live. The international debt accumulated, local debt and international, amounts to 55% of the GDP, meaning that the debt network overwhelms the GDP. What is likely to happen in the next 5 years? All these dams Uganda is proud of may be taken over by the Chinese because of the extreme indebtedness. We cannot keep quiet simply because Uganda is led by NRM. They have failed. They have rendered us a retarded state. We must wake up, do something, provided we are not violent.
Before they even stop you, you have failed to unite yourselves.
Who says we have to unite?
I talk and I hear what people within the opposition say about you as a group, not you as a person.
We launched the mission about 2 weeks ago.
Yes.
The beginning was rough, but after 2 to 3 days we got some easygoing atmosphere. People have started welcoming us everywhere.
How?
Yes, Inup is talking well now, DP is talking reasonably well, Ant is talking reasonably well, although they remain to join.
Is what they say to you what they say in the background?
No, first of all, you must understand that there are some bad elements in every party. The first noise which was blown out was, Mututawanya, you are disturbing us. Why do you disturb the young man in Inup?
Yes.
The attempt to redeem the people of Uganda has no permit. One does not need a permit to fight for freedom. Anybody able-bodied to strike off a balance and redeem the population is free to do so, and we are doing exactly that. What are you saying?
What is your view about the belief that in actual sense, as a matter of fact, this is a way of all of you people that have been in a silent mode trying to regain some momentum on the platform?
You are misunderstanding the trend. Unlike the TD.
You mentioned it, that people are saying you're disturbing the young man in Noop.
Yeah,
it's not my word.
But unlike the TDA, or the Inter-Party Spirit of Cooperation, under Semo Gerere, and respectively, where we moved in to integrate and see who would be most suitable for the presidency, for the prime ministership, this one is a front concentrating on transition. It has no political lifeline. Once we do away with that problem, we cease to exist. We are concentrating on the dynamics of transition. Why has this country spent a whole 59 years without a program that enables a president to hand power to another person?
So there is nothing like using the front as a platform.
Not at all.
For Besigye to shine again.
Not at all. By the way, let me tell you one thing.
Yes.
During our earlier discussion before the launch, even Dr. Besigye has refused. He had refused our appointment.
So, honorable.
Yeah, you will ask people who are there in the meetings. Ask Jema, ask all the other parties. He had refused. He said, I am tired of that position. I want to be in the background to mobilize the population. And he's talented in mobilization. That's why we insisted on him. Otherwise, there were other people who could possibly have been equally good.
You mentioned that actually at the start is when you received more opposition against the idea from your
colleagues. Yes, but as we spoke on, it was eaten away.
Yes, what I want is here. In your heart of hearts, with the information you have and what you know about these political parties, because you are in the same circles, why do you think they were against the idea?
No, they had misunderstood, they had misconstrued the
just
idea.
Just that, yeah. Honorable?
They had misconstrued the idea.
Are you hiding something from the camera?
Not at all. Not at all. They thought we had that motive. Apparently, only to find out later that it was not that motive. The motive was, how do we unite the minds of Ugandans to feel ashamed that for after a whole of 59 years of independence, we have not been able to map out a situation, a benchmark, which enables the transition, a free transition to exist. And it is getting understood by almost three quarters of the population.
Dr. Besigye then must be unhappy with all of you.
Why?
With the attacks he has received ever since the launch and when you mentioned his name as your leader. Is he a happy man with
but
you?
But you must understand, him you must understand, with, different, you must understand with reference to history that all great people are hated people. Jesus Christ, if you read the Bible, the way he was treated by even some of his disciples is amazing.
Museveni must be a great man.
Every person who is great will face greatness. Honorable, in terms of contest.
Honorable, in that sense, Museveni must be a great man.
Why is he?
He is hated by many, including yourself.
If in your analysis that makes him great, it is up to you.
I'm basing it on your submission that all great people are hated.
Well,
this is a man that has all the political sides, parties apart from NRM, making sure, trying to make sure that he's out of office.
He told us when he came from the bush that one of the main reasons why he has come to power, he has come to liberate us from dictators, is because he wants to fight the legacy of people who want to stay in power indefinitely. And he's doing exactly that.
At least, what are those things that you would credit Museveni about?
His attempt to liberate the army into an understanding grouping. But he's failing because he thinks every cause of sanity must be followed with an expanded army. That is why we have a very big army. There is no need for us to have a big army if there was sufficient peace within the country. We happen to have a very big army because the atmosphere is such that without employing a big army, people will be violent. Another point, good point about President Museveni. By the way, President Museveni should have already gone if it were not the value he employed during liberation to engage the Kabaka of Buganda. Professor Mazui, whom you may have heard about, whom at one time I served as a research assistant, the Department of Political Science at Makerere University, once said that Obote is misbehaving. He does not know what Uganda is. If I were Obote, I would not have isolated Buganda, because anybody who wants to govern Uganda must get closer to Buganda. President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni succeeded initially to entice Buganda in his support. Okay? That is why, up to now, he has not been fought in the way others have been fought. People would have gone to Luero too if Kabaka Mutebi was not in existence. A person like John Ken Lukyamuzi, who is a great lover of the Kabaka, I feel ashamed to go to the bush, because the moment I go to the bush, my Kabaka will run away from turmoil. That is state of life has kept Museveni in the pipeline of leadership, circumstantially.
I want to take you back to the...
I hope you understand that.
Very well. Back to the front as we get off it. What is your plan? Because I've heard, besides your colleagues in the opposition taking vows not to join you, the police is ready for you. And other security agencies.
The Electoral Commission, under which this crusade would follow, has already clarified the situation that it has nothing to do with our problem. We should be free, provided we are peaceful.
But haven't you heard the police saying they are ready?
Police is misconceived. It should also go slow, because we know what we are doing. So the rest of the people you are talking about will soon join us also.
We see coup d'etats returning in the political space of Africa. Sudan, Mali, and recently Guinea. First of all, what do you think explains this? We had taken so many years away from that kind of a spate. What explains it, the return of coup d'etats in Africa?
First of all, many African leaders have failed to stick to the benchmark of transition. While they are still lingering about that transition order, defying it, sometimes changing the constitution arbitrarily, they are also faced with the insurgency of the Arabs, the Islamic fighting fronts. And that is diverting the population from concentrating on the bettering of the political dimension in terms of political equity to ensure that elections periodically and meaningfully take place in Africa. But at the same time, I think we should go back to the chapter of Kwame Nkrumah. Many of these African leaders still have a legacy of Kwame Nkrumah. Kwame Nkrumah, by Professor Mazoi's analysis, Professor Mazoi said Kwame Nkrumah was a good African, but a bad citizen of Ghana. Yeah, because he was thinking in terms of bettering the lives of the African people before he would better the lives of the Ghanaians. It is important for us, for populations in Africa and the leaders in Africa, to concentrate on the plight of their respective own populations before they embark on the notion of Pan-Africanism.
That's one of the reasons why we have coup d'etats.
Many of these leaders, by enticing and at a suicidal encompassing of leaders in terms of brotherhood with the rest of the African leaders, they think they are safe at home when they sing the song of Pan-Africanism beyond the songs of Zambia and Tanzania, respectively.
The young men that have taken power through the coups have promised a lot. In Guinea, I hear of a 6-month transition with a 6-month transitional president who is 41 years old, a colonel in the military. Do you see these young men giving out power after the transitional period?
The emergence of the younger military men in Africa over the takeover is in existence because of the dominant dictatorial force surrounding their governments. And that is creating a chance for them to act even in circumstances where they don't have the might to
and the young men just taking advantage of that situation to also take power.
They are taking advantage, but in a very bad economic arrangement. Many of them will be fed by the economy of scale. So take the case of Mali, take the case of Sudan. There was a lot of fire, jubilation after the takeover, but the eventuality is chaotic.
So you agree with me if I say...
I would like to advise...
If I say, much as we have the dictatorial systems, coup d'etats would not be the same, the right path?
Not only that, coup d'etats are not the solution to the problem. Because you go for a coup d'etat and then you return to zero from where you are.
I want us to wind up with Kenya. I was listening to you somewhere and you mentioned Raila Odinga as a friend to you.
He's a personal friend, yes.
Okay, he's in a race of which we'll see a showdown in 2022. What is your view of what is happening in Kenya?
Well, the handshake which was employed by Uhuru Kenyatta and Raila Odinga is not yet dead. I think it was deliberately initiated to make sure that they reduce the divide between the two forces. You remember Orange and the Jubilee were ruffians, but now they are friendly, and I'm sure they can build the front of success. I am very worried about Ruto. He is a very proficient person. He was a former lecturer at the University of Nairobi, and I used to see him in some of the assemblies. But he has not calculated his stance of action. If Uhuru Kenyatta found space for him, there would be no problem for him being patient enough to wait for a suitable turn. What is happening now is exactly similar to what nearly happened between Mama Mbabazi and President Museveni. If your boss changes the mind set by saying, because of the circumstance in existence, I am now forwarding this man, you should be good enough to work closely with him, because he has also...
Isn't this Ruto's time also to shine? Because if this opportunity goes, who knows what will happen later on?
Well, it is not, because he comes from a unique tribe, which would have a unique opportunity in the next turn should Raila Odinga go out of power.
One of an aspect that we have to get rid of in our politics as Africa, the tribal connections and connotations.
Yeah, the tribal connections should not necessarily be referred to as animosity, because unless they are misused. Very soon we are also announcing here in Uganda that we need a new governance style. The system of government under Museveni is indescribable. You can't call it Musevenism, you can't call it unitary. It is a mixture of events of confusion in economics. So we would like Uganda to come out with a new government system which empowers the regions, especially the regions that saw the founding of the Uganda nation in 1962. As we speak now, nearly 70% of the taxes come from Wakiso and Kampala. If we had an arrangement which empowers the region substantially in the form of executive powers, in the form of sovereignty, in the form of functions, those cities and regions elsewhere would be able to nurture an economic empowerment to the inhabitants capable of adding value to the consolidated fund.
Thank you so much, Honorable Lukyamuzi.
Thank you too.
Just a comment about the environment. We no longer hear you that vibrant like you used to be about the environment.
Well, I was right now I'm
in some village and what used to be a forest.
Yeah.
Right there now, are plots right, being demarcated.
Right
for sale.
Now, I am very worried about the laxity of government in regard to our deforestation and wetland reclamation. Don't be surprised when, in the short run, the power underneath the dams will water down and the rivers may dry and even the turbines fail to blow the water across. Why? Because President Museveni is getting too excited with the waterfalls, with the dams. The power of dams is dependent on the function of waterfalls. The way we are feeding the water table underground, the rivers and the lakes and the rivers, is so narrow that we are worried that under the present state of 8% of the remaining forest cover in the country, in the next 20 years or so, those dams may no longer be in function. By now, President Museveni and his government would have designed a cook stove which economizes energy from Pakwachi to Kabari. If it is used or bought by every family, we should be able to reduce the encroachment on the forest cover, without which ordinary people cannot live because they have to cook food.
Thank you so much.
Above all, the president should think of reducing the tariffs of electricity, because as we speak, very few institutions can use hydroelectricity for cooking because it's too expensive. In the 1960s, a unit of electricity was at 1 shilling. Right now, it is above 1,000 shillings.
Thank you so much, the Honorable John Ken Lukyamuzi, the man from Lubaga, and we visited him in his constituency where he stays. He's no longer the MPs, but he's a resident.
I still command.
Okay, he says he still commands. We visited him here to have a chat about issues to do with his main field, and that is politics, and I'm sure you have listened and followed. My name is Michael Jordan Lukoma with my main man, Davis Kamukama, Glory Ragwitabinja, and the whole team. Wish you the best of the evening. Bye-bye and good night.
This weekend, Youth of Purpose.
Let's work together to make sure that the environment breathes. We'll also be able to breathe safely and keep our environment safe.
Every resource that we're using, we're borrowing from someone that has not even yet been born. So they should take care of the world and try to go as much green as possible.
Our environment is dying out. Things people dispose of so badly. So they are going to harm the future generation, and we have to prepare for them. And it all starts with me.
It is a really big honor living in a country that is called the most beautiful in the entire continent. So let's all do our best to make Uganda the best.
Uganda first. This weekend on UBC.
If dance is an orphan, the film industry will definitely be by far the black sheep of the local industry. My next guest's name may not be as popular as his work, but Lukman Ali most definitely has an exceptional touch.
I'm not different at all. It's just that I've always had, I guess I set my goals too high. It's too high that it's sometimes depressing. People have been making movies, but the issue has always been, how do you get the money back? How do you get the money back? So now I know you can't sell a product that people don't know.
Up next on UBC, brought to you by...
Keep the lights on. Use Airtel Money to pay for all your Yaka bills conveniently. Open the My Airtel app to buy Yaka units. Airtel Money. Simple, secure, borderless.